Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I have the pleasure to introduce the lecture of today. The title is The Type of Petroleum Agreements, Negotiations and the Technique. The speaker is Carlo Clerici. Carlo Clerici is joined the Eni 25 years ago. He is the manager of upstream negotiation for East and Oceania ENI MP division. He is a member of the Association of International Petroleum Negotiation, and he conducts negotiation in all major geographic areas where ENI is operator. The focus of the speech is on the structure and basic terms provided for the main type of upstream petroleum agreements, usually concluded between the authorities of the countries and the oil companies. The presentation will also include a description of the recent trends in the international contractual practices. So I give the floor to Carlo. And if you have a question, I don't know how many people are connected now. 39. So we have 39 points for this lecture, and the question at the end of the presentation.
Thank you, Lina. Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to everybody. And as Ida Zanino said, we will touch this morning briefly the main type of agreements and the main type of negotiations. So this is the agenda we will follow. It will deal with the three main kinds of agreements, so the concession agreement, the production sharing agreement, and the service contract. We will talk briefly about the joint operating agreement, and we will go through the main type of negotiations and the tactics we usually use during our meetings. Then at the end we will have some possible questions, a brief discussion. I would like to say something about the main reasons why an oil company decides to invest in a country, and why a country that we call usually a host country receives the investment of an oil company. Very briefly, the IOC, the International Oil Company, has a target to discover resources, hydrocarbons, oil and gas, and to book the relevant research. That is very important for our company to have as an element of the asset. Then to obtain, under the economic point of view, an appropriate reward for the risk we incur, that are big ones as we all know. We invest at risk in exploration phase. If we find we develop, if we do find hydrocarbons, we lose our money. So it is a very risky field. So we need to study an appropriate reward under economic point of view. And to have the possible enlargement as an asset to have the growth of our company. These are the three main reasons. The host country has other reasons, while, for example, share the risk and to find and develop the resources, to develop the economy of the country, because most of the countries where we invest are developing countries, and we have to remember that their economy is still based on the hydrocarbon resources development. So they need to share the risks to develop such resources, such property they have, generate cash flow and the economic growth of the country. And also, one important point, one important need that they have is to grow their resources, human resources, the young people, through training courses and through the transfer of technology. So there is a room, and this is why we conclude a petroleum contract. The room is this one, room to cooperate, because as in all kind of negotiations, we have different needs which match, and we can conclude the agreement. When we invest in a country as oil company, what we do usually at the beginning? We have two different levels of investigation. One is the understanding of the package of laws which will govern our activities. So the petroleum law and the tax code which regulates the fiscal regime. The laws of a country in general usually provide, for example, for the procedures of award of a contract of an area through private negotiations or through bidding round. This last one, the bidding round, organization of bidding round, is the most used in the last decade, I would say. Then they provide, for example, the skills that an oil company has to keep very clearly in mind, to be technically skilled and also, under financial point of view, capable, because we said it is our activity, it is a risky activity under the technical point of view, but we have also, I think, that we remember that we need a lot of money. It is capital intensive. The field of hydrocarbons activities is a capital intensive field. So, first, we need to understand the package of laws. Package of laws. Then we come to see what the petroleum contract will provide. The petroleum contract will be inserted in this package of laws. And it is important to say, because in case of inconsistency between some provision that we can write in the contract and the law prevails in any case. So it is important. First level, the understanding of the laws. Second level, to discuss and agree on a petroleum contract between the government of a country and the oil company, which will last many years and will include, for example, the minimum commitment, work commitment the oil company will do, how many wells, how many seismic activity, and so on. The financial commitment, how much we will as minimum will spend in that area, in that country. How we decide, because we cannot go in an host country and do what we want. We are in a certain sense at their home. So we have to balance our autonomy in the decision making process as oil company and the needs of the host country which develop their own resources, their property. Then how we find, how we will declare a commercial discovery, for example, because we can find some hydrocarbons, maybe is not enough to be developed under economic point of view. So we need to fix a set of rules and the procedure to declare the commercial discovery. And every other provision like the title to production, how we dispose of the production we find, every kind of thing which will govern 30, maybe 30, 35 years of activity from now. As we will see, the structure of the agreement, I think, is very simple, the structure. The contract with the all provisions to be written is very complex, because we need to look in possibly in 30 years from now. So it's not so easy. It's not so easy. That's the difficulty, in my opinion. The structure is very simple. We will see. So we come to the three main agreements, petroleum agreements between the host government and the oil companies, concession agreement, production sharing agreement, service contract. Then we will look briefly on the joint operating agreement, which is an agreement between the companies, the foreign companies, which are together to invest in the country, because it is the field is risky, because it is capital intensive, and there are other many reasons, we usually we don't go alone to invest in a country on 100%, but we share, we come together with other companies. So the JOA, the Joint Operating Agreement, is a second level of contract. It's not the petroleum contract between the government and the oil company, but an agreement between the companies of a group of companies investing. First point to take into account, in my opinion, is what is the difference, the really basic difference between a concession agreement and the other agreement? The title to production. The concession agreement, under legal point of view, is the only agreement which gives the property of the hydrocarbons to the foreign company as soon as the oil or gas comes at the surface. Because below, in any case, is property of the state, is their resource. When it comes, if we are good and lucky, and it comes at the subsoil, the title property becomes of the concessionaire. While in the production sharing agreement and in the service agreement, the title, in any case, the property, it is in any case of the government. When it comes to the subsoil and the wellhead and so on, the property is still in the hands of the government. The concession agreement is the oldest type of contract. The structure is very simple. What happens? Let's put this example. We are, for example, one only company investing in the country, in that block, 100%. We sign a concession agreement with the government. We have the right to conduct the operation. If we will find hydrocarbons, as soon as they come, as we said, at the subsoil, we will have title property to such production. It's our production, it's our title. What happens? The government will take from this production we have a percentage that we call royalty. We pay in cash or in kind, and we take out, if it is paid in kind, we take out this part of the gross production and we give to the government. Then we pay other things we will see, but the structure is we take our production, a part of the royalty, we sell in the international market, we have certain revenues, we will make a fiscal declaration and we will pay the profit tax on that. So the concession is very simple, the structure. We have production, it's our production, we take out the royalty, we sell our production, we will make a fiscal declaration and we will pay taxes on that. So it is like this. Excuse me to be so simple, but in my opinion is better to see the barrel. The government takes the royalty, the and the taxes, and the rest of the production is given to the international company. This is the structure of the concession agreement. These are the concession agreements of any. So we have a lot of concession agreements, and I would say that still today, most of the oil companies conclude concession agreements, more concession agreements than production sharing agreements or service contracts. The production sharing contract. The production sharing contract, it was formulated in the 60s in Indonesia. It is also well used. It is very simple. Also the structure of the PSA, the structure is simple in my opinion. What happens? If we are good and also sometimes a little bit lucky, we have a discovery of hydrocarbons, so we produce. Of the production, a part of the production that we call cost oil, or cost gas if you find gas, but to be easy, as example, cost oil, this percentage of the gross production will be used by the oil company to recover the cost he has incurred during exploration and then development and production phase, according to certain provisions, very detailed provisions, but we have no time, unfortunately, to get enter into detail now, but there are certain procedures on the basis of which we recover our costs. If we don't find a discovery, we lose our money. Lose our money. That's why we need a second element in the contract, that is the profit oil or profit gas, if it is gas that we find, in order to remunerate the risk we have incurred, the great risk. Our specialists have been very good, they have found, we have to be remunerated. So this is the profit oil, that is, in fact, the remaining part of the production. So part of the production is given to the oil company to recover the cost. The remaining part is the profit oil, which is shared between the government and the oil company, according to certain mechanisms, and that part that we will keep is for our remuneration. Well, often the national oil company of a country participates in the activities, but not from the beginning, not in the exploration phase, because it is a risk, so they leave the risk to the companies. When we discover oil or gas, they can come in and finance the development and production phases and so on, and will so be carried, we use this definition, the national company will be carried during the exploration phase. Well, when we recover the exploration expenditures, we recover at least with certain interest, LIBOR plus 3-4%, what it is, because the time, as we all know in the economics, is a very important parameter. Well, the TSAs decades ago didn't include taxes, didn't include royalties. Now, since two decades or a little bit more, the TSAs include also the payment of a royalty, in kind or in cash. They include the taxes. So we pay also, we take production as cost oil plus a part of the profit oil, we sell in the international market, we will make a fiscal declaration, and we will pay taxes on that. We'll pay taxes on that. So there are elements mixed with the concession agreement. It's not so classic PSA now, since they do. How we share the profit oil? These are the main methods we used. Well, the first one is an old one. We tend not to use it because it is mainly based on technical performance of the field and the operator and so on. So based, we can say, the production, the profit oil, it is shared on basis of cumulative production of the field or daily production. So under a technical view of the field. I remember when the consultant firm is on, two decades ago, in the 90s, we came to see that the technical parameter is not enough, was not enough and appropriate to share the profit oil. So we came to try to find another method of another mechanism of sharing. And it was set this IRR rate of return element. So we say the profit oil is shared between the companies, oil company, and the government of the country based on the IRR of the product. It is very simple to say. To implement is not so easy. And it was one of the basic issues that were handled when this mechanism was studied. Why? Because in general, the economic evaluation, that is a complex one sometimes, is not the equal, identical method, identical run by all the companies, all the parties. So what happens? That you can have an evaluation made by the ministry that is very different sometimes by the evaluation made by the parties. So what we need to do in order not to incur disputes, big disputes on this, is to write carefully and clearly in the contract how we calculate the cash flows, which discount rate we use, this kind of things, very detailed, which cost we include, and so on. This is a more appropriate method to share because it takes into account also the economic aspect of the field. Because another important issue to say, in my opinion, is that the contract applies on a field by field basis. So we have discovered two or three fields in a contract area. We don't, for example, to calculate the cost of it, we don't take the whole production, we put together everything, but each field will have its own cost oil, its own profit oil, and so on. R factor is another method which is in the middle, takes in between the first two elements, because takes into account technical and economical parameters, features. So it is the ratio between the revenues and the cumulative expenses. Where the R factor is less than one, for example, we need to have a bigger share of the cost oil because we have not, profit oil, because we have not still recovered our cost. So we need to have in the sharing of the profit oil a bigger share. Why? Because we have not recovered our investment. Because this sharing of profit oil is based on a sliding scale. So we use this element and we say, for example, for the R factor. When the R factor is less than one, the ministry takes 20% and the oil company 80%. When R factor is between 1 and 1.5, we take lesser as oil company and the ministry takes more. So, and also in the other cases for production, return and so on. The most complex agreements, we have for example some in Central Asia, use a hybrid method. So they provide with certain complex provisions the use of the IRR method of sharing the profit oil and the R factor. And they also say when we use one or the other, according to complex procedures. We have also in Far East, for example, PSAs which use a matrix based on the production level and R factor on the other side. So it is matching two values and we fix the percentages of the profit oil. This is the production sharing mechanism, very simple also this one. We have cost recovery, it comes to the oil company to recover the cost. The profit oil comes to the company as a remuneration, part of the profit oil, comes to the company to remunerate the risk, and the rest of the profit oil comes to the government, which will receive also taxes and royalties. This is the PSA, and these are the PSAs of Eni, the service agreement. Service agreement is a particular agreement. We don't have many, and in general, the oil companies are not, in general, happy to do this kind of agreement. We will see very soon why. How it works? Very simply. We conduct activities, we finance also activities, because it is still a risk contract, a risk service contract, and if we find a discovery, we will be repaid in cash, usually in cash, for the investment we have made. On top of that, we have a fee per barrel, which remunerates us for the risk incurred. And the fee, the service fee, can be a very complex one. So, the point very important to be outlined here in the service contract, and this is the main reason for which I would say, when we talk about service contract, we have to be careful, and many people are very careful to talk about that, because if we are paid in cash for our investment and we will be remunerated in cash through the fee for the risk incurred, we have the great risk not to be able to book reserves. This is essential for us. As we said at the beginning of the conversation, we need booking the reserve. So if we get cash and not the production in kind, this can be a great problem. So there are service agreements on the basis of which we receive payment and remuneration in kind, and we can book clearly our reserves. So there are specialists for also for this field in the company which can tell you more than me the details, but the main concept is this one. These are the service contracts we have in Eni. There are not many. We have very few. One is in here, still currently in Iraq, and the one that is signed here we don't have really. It is concluded years ago in Iran. It was concluded when it was possible to conclude agreement in that country, but then there were sanctions, as we all know. So in Iran we are not investing since a lot of years. It is colored here because we are recovering our cost, the last amount we have to recover based on a service contract. I would finish the petroleum agreement with two things. One is what we really need as negotiators when we come at the table, what we look for essential as essential clauses. The contract stability, especially if the country is a developing country, we need to say that tomorrow we will not subject to increase of 200% of the income tax or big increases of the royalties and so on. So we need to say what we fix today as a balance, technical and economic balance in the agreement, we take and keep it fixed. But it is, I would say, the recent trend is that it's not so easy to be negotiated. In the countries now, they tend, also in developing countries, to reject. We have some negotiation with difficulties to contract this clause. Then, as we say, the booking of reserves, there are some examples here, some issues, but I would underline the booking of reserves. This is very important for us. When the analysts come to our company, they look at many things, but basically also one, the booking of reserves, the amount of reserves booked is essential point. The valuation of oil based on the realized price in the international market is also important, and international arbitration. 2 minutes on the recent trend. What the negotiations are facing now? Some recent trend outline this fact, for example. The host country is not available to conclude, as in the past, only the petroleum contract. Let's say the PSA, the concession agreement. They are requiring a larger intervention of our company. So, for example, they ask for a power plant, product for which produce electricity and so on. They can ask for a gas plant. They can ask for shipyards, for something that is not strictly connected to our investment. Because if they require, for example, if we find if we are doing a negotiation to better develop a giant field in a country, that's fine. If they request a gas plant for or in connection with that field, is something that we can easily accept, we make calculation, we make the appropriate negotiation, and so on. But if they ask, for example, some industrial project that is not connected with our petroleum activities, this can be a problem, because this can be a project of $200 million. And we do not know immediately how we can be sure to recover our investments made. The negotiation becomes difficult. And this is the case of the recent last 5 years, 6 years. It's very recent, but it's clear. Cooperation. The host country requests a cooperation. Well, if it is to build a training center, $45-50 million, we can handle the matter, we can recover from the cost oil of the petroleum contract, such cost, for example. But I said, if they are asking something more complex, it is a problem. Second trend, the local content and procurement. The countries are requesting to train their people, but especially to use their local contractors. It is a provision we have had since decades, no? To use, to make evaluation of what we can use in the country as a good or service, if it is of good quality, good standard, similar price. But the point now, and the trend, very recent trend, is that, for example, in certain countries, the law, the petroleum law, provides for a percentage, let's say 40%, of local goods and services to be provided in the country. What happens if the local contractor, to be very sincere, is in negotiation? We say that. If in a country we have only few local contractors available, and you have to take 20 local contractors, how will become your project? It can be dangerous. It can be, very frankly, they know that. We know that. Because if they don't perform, we have certain rights and obligations in the contract. If we spend 8 months to drill a simple well instead of 3 months, it's a problem. If it costs twice, it's a problem. Because when we will come to the authorities to ask the recovery, they will say, why this cost is so much? So this is the other trend. This trend is a special one also. ASE, Earth Safe Environment. This is a point that we need to carefully view. There are more requests by the host countries in the petroleum contract. Well, there is growing consciousness of the importance of this argument in the oil companies that organize with a very ample, good level, important level department procedures, and also in the host country. They request, for example, to have reports, periodic surveys, risk assessment, environmental assessment. All the our colleagues know very well the level of big requests they do. The cost are connected to this. The human resources connected to this. It is an important point. It is important because, as we know, we have seen big damages, no? We know in Gulf of Mexico and so on. So, without entering into detail, as it is written, we have consciousness because it is better to prevent. Because if we make a big damage, it's a problem. And the balance sheet of the company, can, of any, for example, of BP, for example, in my opinion, I think, can be disregarded, can be put at risk. So it is a big problem. In the negotiation, apart from the reflection in the provision that are more stringent, there is committee, there is audit, everything, they ask parent company guarantees, and not for $50 or $100 million. They ask sometimes ultimate parent company guarantees for $400 million. It means parent company by any SPA. So it's a problem. This, I would say very briefly, this is a point to be carefully analyzed and negotiated, because the contract, as I said, has lasted 30 years, and it's a point. Very brief focus on the joint operating agreement. We have seen in the petroleum contract we have host country and oil company, but oil company, as we said, because of the risk and so on, they come together, 1, 2, 3, 4 companies. So they come together to share this risk and financement. How they regulate their rights and obligations between them? Through the joint operating agreement, which is a contract is a contractual arrangement, contractual arrangement, through which they govern, the four companies here govern their relationships. This is what we said. There is one operator, very briefly, one operator is companies, is the leading one, is the company which award the contracts, make through subcontractors the operations, keep the contact with the authorities, make the calculation, for example, in PSA of cost oil, profit oil, these kind of things, the recovery of cost. So it is important role. Even if the operator, we write in the documents, has not to lose or gain, has not to lose or gain, is important. Then there is a body called usually operating committee, comprised of members from each of the parties, which decide on the main issues. So we need a work program budget. We need to decide where to drill a well. We need to decide how much of the area we will relinquish, for example, after a few years. So we fix percentage, voting passmark, above which the decision is taken. Certain decisions are very important, so they require the unanimous vote. So it's not a percentage, but 100%. So, for example, declaration of commercial discovery. We find accumulation of hydrocarbons. How it works? We make calculation to see selling this production estimated to be so and so in that part of the world, international market. We have incurred this cost. Well, you know better than me. So we make calculation, we see if the net present value and the result is positive. So we can invest. Because we can also find, and this is another important chapter of our story, but we don't touch today, we can find marginal field. So we find, but it's not enough. In another chapter we don't touch, we find a very big field that we think that is very economically viable, and maybe is not so viable. So these are complex matters in any case. Why we have given, we have made this very brief conversation? Many people are experts. We have a lot of very high level experts, researchers in the company we know very well. I think that their work, we think, I think, everybody thinks, their work and the knowledge of the main features of the contract is important, because they can know that their product, so the analysis of a seismic survey, environmental assessment, these kind of things, is very important because it has impact in the provision of the contract. So they know how their work, it is important, how much is important, and how it is included in this big framework of the petroleum contract. This is why I think that it is good thing to have a brief talk sometimes about the contract. Now we come to another chapter, that is the type of negotiations and tactics. Because the negotiator has two main, excuse me to be so rough, but two main functions. One is to prepare the document or to work on a petroleum contract, on a joint operating agreement. The other function is to negotiate it. It's not the same thing. The best you try to negotiate, the best conditions you will have. The negotiation is a process, is an interactive process between two or more parties to find an agreement on the ground of common interest and then to formalize this agreement in a petroleum contract that will be honored by all parties. This simple, I hope, nice picture is just to say, as every person, every negotiator, every group of negotiations by a company has its own head with a lot of variables inside. The mindset of every one of us is different. is different because differences in the experience of studies, of work, of negotiation, of the framework and use of the company where the negotiator works. So, for example, let me say just some things nice. One, in any case, is more emotional. The other one makes some indifference. One is resilient. One has a lot of passion. The other one makes pressure to conclude soon certain things. Everyone, for example, just on this part of the small picture, it creates a different approach. For certain people, no negotiation is ever final. Well, this is but is amazing. I'm saying that not to create evaluation, but the cultures in Russia, in Kazakhstan, and so on, for example, are like that. The agreement is signed, but sometimes it can be signed another time, or but it's not evaluation. It's amazing, I would say. It's amazing because it's culture also. We are our culture and the others. That we have to take into account. The skills of communication, speaking, listening. One talks a lot. He takes the floor and begins to discuss, and the others have difficulty to intervene. So this is just to say, when we sit at a table, we have to know that we have different counterpart, in the different counterpart, different people, everyone has its own mindset. Still today, they have made, the specialists have made a lot of studies during the case, also at Harvard and so on. Still today, I would say, the category is very simple of the negotiation. That is a difficult process, to be good in negotiation, as in every job, but I'm talking my job. It is difficult one. You can learn for a life, and I don't know if we become good negotiator. So one kind, in any case, one kind of a negotiation is the distributive negotiation. So the parties are at the table trying to win over the other. So they have a competitive approach. A simple example is the discussion between a seller and a customer of a carpet on the price. If the discount is made, the customer has a certain advantage, and the seller has a lesser price. This is the distributive. The integrative negotiation is the negotiation based on which the parties try to integrate their needs, to understand, to exchange ideas, to be, as we said in the preceding slide, more open to the counterpart, more open, not to be so flexible to give up everything, but open to understand. Open, this is the basic point in a negotiation. Very simple example, excuse me very much, but I think it's very effective. Two parties have 10 oranges as a target to take. If they, through search of information, opening their minds and so on, if they have this exchange of ideas, they can ideally take all the oranges available. The two parties, each party takes the maximum. Why? Because at the beginning, if they use distributive approach, they can try to take the more number of oranges they want. But if they are little bit open-minded to try slowly to understand why a party wants the orange, the parties can understand that they have different needs. One needs the pulp, the fruit pulp, because they need to make orange juice, and the other party needs the peel because they want to make. They want to make some receipt of sweet and so on. And they take together, the two parties, the maximum number, all the 10 oranges. The distributive is the usual pie that we divide. This is very important, I say to me, not, I don't know, I hope also that some interest. The dilemma. When you sit down in front of a team, let's say that it's first time. As you begin discussing, what is your approach? Because the negotiation is not obviously all the whole distributive or the whole integrative. It comes up and down, no? Between distributive, between and integrative. And then we see another one, but the two main categories are these. So there is the so-called negotiator's dilemma. What do you do when you sit down and begin discussing? Because, and then what you do in the following phases, taking into account what has happened during the first step. This matrix, what says really? Your counterpart and you. You are here, your counterpart are me. I am your counterpart. If I defect, I'm competitive. I'm the ministry. I ask you 3 wells in 2 years. The drilling of 3, just to be very practical. 3 wells in 2 years. You say, well, it is not very good for us. We can try, we can handle. Let's put this sentence in order to be flexible and give the counterpart the idea that we want to conclude soon. And good agreement, obviously, for everybody, for us especially. But let's give this cooperation signal. And we accept. Let's put the case that in the following round, after 1 week, the counterpart of I come back. Well, that point was fine. We discussed about 3 wells in 2 years, but I look with my technician, my expert, you can drill 3 wells in 1 year and 2 months. Well, if the example is this, if you continue to accept, you will be easily found yourself here, so to have a bad result for you, because I take what you accept and put in the pocket. Then the next time I continue me to defect, to cooperate, to be competitive. You see, cooperate, you are here. So for you a very bad result with the negotiation. The same for the counterpart. So this is to say that as idea, because as I said, I don't know if I'm a good negotiator. So I'm saying what I feel really. The complex thing is to try to balance the phases of negotiation in order to balance what you take and what you give up. And to assume integrative approach, it means to try to understand, as the oranges, the needs of the counterpart and your needs. Let's say, for example, the case of the wells, you can come back and say, yes, we can accept this, but why you accept the financial commitment more or less, not zero, but very low, and you insist. And if the counterpart does not give a signal on this, You reject. Well, this is simple to say here and theoretically. When we are in a country, first of all, or between companies, we need to know the contractual and negotiation weight of the parties. Because there are also these variables to be taken into account that are used. First thing to be understood, what is your weight? Because you can talk theoretically as you like, but it depends also on the weight you have. This is the worst that can happen as a third category, the negotiation on position. And it happens sometimes, not frequently, but it happens. The two parties continue to insist on their own position. They continue, and the more they continue, the more difficult for them is to come out without losing the face. For example, to insist on my position, I take the expert that comes to the room, say, well, this is international reputed expert, he will explain in a natural way why my request is so good and so on. The counterpart will do similar things. They will use media some media, television, and so on, newspapers, and so on. They use, they don't do that. At the end, no one can leave the table without losing the face. The only thing in this case that is a little bit complex is to find the way to have another solution, another issue that to which we will give good weight in order to save the face to the party of the two which give us the position and to possibly conclude the matter. We have to save one of the two, have to save the other, and giving him some important issue for him. How we create integrative negotiation, where the atmosphere, the open mind approach, the body language also is important. There are a lot of variables. And this graph also represents what it is needed. We have consideration for ourselves, but also for the others. If we look at this part of the graph, here there is a lose-win or win-lose situation. So we have to take, the story is the same, we have to take into account the needs of the other, having in our mind our target, our basic target to be taken. This is a principle, it is true. You must never try to make all the money, that's in a deal. Let the other fellow make some money too. And especially in our negotiations, because we, as any as all the major oil companies in the world, we have a frequent negotiation with the same counterpart. If you win very much, let's say, with another company, let's say with Total, with that negotiator, that group of negotiation, what do you think? The next time you will do an initiative with them, you will have a counterpart so hard that it will be difficult for you to negotiate. Tactics. We have to say, it is not true that we use tactics, so we will be sure to obtain something. This is obviously not true. What we know is that everybody uses tactics. After a few years, also the young negotiators have to know that these are used and to recognize them. To recognize them, at least. This is happens. To me, it happened 3 weeks ago, just to be very clear. Exactly this. Exactly this. The attitude is that of the woman. To be the counterpart shouts a lot. I mean, 8-10 minutes, that is a lot of time. That your side and the other party shouts a lot. 8, 9, 10 minutes is a universe of time. You be calm, you are quiet. When he's a sort of theater also that he does, the counterpart. When he finish, you begin calm. It's difficult, even when I have a certain character also, it is difficult. You keep calm. When he finish, you begin back from what you were saying. Exactly the same word. Exactly the same word. This is a message. The negotiation is also, I think, a matter of clear messages. When a message is clear, is needed because the negotiation becomes tough, it is needed. A clear message, attitude, it is clearly needed. This is what we said, no? Let's be subtle about this. We want to do business with them in the future, the phase we said before. Few tactics, because I don't want to keep you along, but few tactics. You know, I think these are very well known. The first one was at the time, but not now, very 2 decades ago, was adopted by the Iraqi negotiation team, but I repeat, decades ago. But now it is also used. When the group is large, you cannot do if you are 2 or 3 at the table. Large one. You organize before the meeting, obviously. One of your colleagues will be the bad guy. So, in a coherent way, it will make expression with the face to reject what the other party is saying, to be contrary to everything is proposed. And you, or the lead negotiator, can come as the man who make easier things. It is a very easy tactic, but I see that he has still today certain impact. Competition is a tactic that usually the ministries sometimes use. We have discussed since a month on a certain project, phases and so on of a contract. Suddenly, a competitor comes out, appears. You don't know if it is true or not. That's the point, because maybe not, but you have the doubt. They use today. Yesterday, we had a contact. 3 wells in 2 years. He makes 3 wells in 1 year. That is an example. They use. Last minute request nibbling is widely used in certain countries, widely used. Even if the document is initialed, when the translation comes in, in the translation appear certain, not typo, but different numbers, different things. So, the remedy here is one of the remedies, because maybe the management is already coming ready to sign, or you have said that the negotiation is closed. So, the high-level manager, they are taking the plane to come and to execute. You have a negotiator to explain why they will not sign, or there is this change. It's not so simple. So, the best thing is, in advance, agree everything, including the translation, everything. And in any case, there can be some problem, in any case. But, well, this is something that we cannot call an expert, we saw. Cherry picking is another tactic used by the authorities in general. Let's say that we have a private dealing in a country. We propose an offer. We say, okay, we are interested to be awarded that block number 10 in that country. We offer this minimum commitment for wells in 3 years with this financial commitment, minimum financial commitment. We have this, we propose this cost oil, this profit oil, and that you participate with certain participating. The authorities take your offer and they make the cherry pick. They say, well, the 3 wells in 3 years is okay, cost oil is fine, profit oil no, so all apart. No, participation is too low, we want more. And they come back willing to discuss only those 2 items. This is widely used. I don't know which remedy. One remedy is that we presented a package. That's the package. Stop. If you want more cost oil, we decrease the number of wells. And we negotiate on that. No? This is what we try to do. Deadlines, we also use SAV sometimes. It is effective sometimes less, a little bit lesser, but we say that we have to conclude in 2 months because the timing is this, the momentum is this, we have also objective technical reasons sometimes, because in certain countries you cannot go there and drill when you want along the year, because in a certain part of the year maybe there is a typhoon in certain countries, there is the ice in others and so on. So we push also using these deadlines. This is nice if you can, it's successful in my opinion, find an agent for you. Usually the group you have in your front, as our group, is not the same thinking, same behavior, same attitude. If you are so skilled and to look very careful, you can identify one person in the counterpart that can help you when there is informal moment with the coffees, lunch or dinner, so on. Not very much artificial, but a little bit. You be in touch with this person and explain better to him certain reasoning, trying to persuade him, in order that he works for you in his group. And maybe he's competing with his own colleagues, and you can take benefit of this. So this is that. I personally use this one, but not so artificially. But it is a tactic everyone knows. new negotiator, when it happens, it can be a big problem. Let's say the case that the counterpart, also between companies, at certain point, due to certain lasting of the negotiation and so on, do not accept the terms that you have fixed, for the negotiation. What happens? It happens that you can try to substitute the negotiator, saying that he had assignment suddenly to another country. There is new negotiator, and it is more easy to come back to discuss certain issues. Also the company's uses. This creates problems for negotiators, for growth, for the manager who obviously wants to hear that the document is concluded and so on. The negotiation begins also before the meeting, sometimes. Location, place, timing. I can put the, well, with the minimum good behavior between people, but for example, the life in general are something, the natural life, important for the human being, for the people. You put your counterpart in a room without windows. Small coffee or only water. Very bad. I had the difficulty to find a so bad room like this, but this can be example. Why? Minimum behavior could be. You make the message. You are not, I'm not happy. I don't want to negotiate again with you on this basis. The message to be clear. We cannot say that, as I said now. I give the message. Body language, okay, this is, I'm concluding. Body language, it opens the door to an amazing chapter of the negotiation, because two parties who are looking at themselves, also without talking, they are exchanging hundreds of signs, and the good negotiator can be or should be able to understand more, even if the other one doesn't talk. Okay, these are very simple examples. I'm not talking exactly of this that everyone of us knows, but well, it happens. If you see one like this in front of you, it means that you're not so interested, maybe, or is not interested in your proposal. The madam here can be closer. But I say to me, be careful, because let's just one a very brief example. When I saw some Japanese, for example, is a lot evaluation. I have some characteristics, others. They generally do not look in your eyes. And one that does not know them can think, well, it's strange this thing. It's not strange, but you have not to know because it's their culture. So this is just a brief example because this has to be interpreted according to the different cultures. Last thing, this is the last, as I understand, very difficult one. It is the last frontier of the negotiation. It is amazing. I'm not able to do it, but use of emotions, artificial, but not so much to be understood by the other, to use emotions in the discussion to gain benefit from that. And I will say also, it is not true that the negotiator, this is an opinion, but I think is also shared in general, it is not true, we have not to imagine a negotiator who is a calm person every time listening, every time mediating. This is not the truth. This is not the truth. The negotiator at a certain point has to use messages, clear messages, be strong sometimes if needed, and I don't recommend, this is very difficult, it can also create tensions at a certain point, actively, artificially in the meeting, because we said before, no? We have to create a good atmosphere, good in order to be integrative. This is true. But the last frontier is also the same. In certain passages of the negotiation, we can be strong. We can use tensions and create tension in the room, in the group, if a minute, to gain from that. That is very, it's very difficult to give them, but it is the last frontier of the negotiation. So, very last sentence, I think we have been in 1 year and very, because it is important also that to leave a time for discussion, if it is possible, between us, a little bit discussion. When we have a constructive and cooperative negotiation, in general, usually we obtain a balanced agreement, and we can easily sign and be happy with what we have concluded. So my purpose this morning, it was just in 1 hour to give structures of the contract, the main contract, and ideas on how the negotiation process takes place. And there are a lot of other things. Thank you. Dov'è? Aspetta, la leggo su qui? Ci sono delle domande? There are some questions here? In the world there are some questions in the arena. Aspetta, le leggo una. Ah, le metti tutte? No, comincio da questa, la leggo un attimo prima. Sì, vuoi leggerla tu? Uguale, leggi. Ah, bello, non so.
Ok. Let's read it from the beginning to everybody. In the AP world, there are several new countries entering in the arena. Which are they to pay contractor schemes? And then there's a second question. In your experience, there's a rule of thumb which links country maturity and technical characteristics. Oil versus gas, onshore versus deep offshore. With the preferred contractor scheme?
Yes, thanks.
Okay.
Yes, there are various new countries entering into the arena. One of the most important we all know is where we, for example, made a very great and big, thanks to our people, discovery in Africa, gas discovery. The preferred scheme, yes, they have in general, when the country is a mature one, becomes to have a preferred scheme. When the country is new in the arena, in general, makes through consultants and also oil companies an overview of the contract, but in general, in my opinion, he has not a very preferred scheme. Let's say, for example, Iraq. Iraq is not entering now in the arena. It is one of the best actors since a lot of decades in the century. But if we consider entering newly in the arena when they propose a certain contract, well, they propose a service contract, even if it would have been profitable to discuss also, maybe together with the service contract, other schemes. African countries are maybe not focusing specifically to a certain agreement. They can take a PSA. They can take a PSA that in the mind of everybody, it is an agreement that is more easy also under management point of view to be handled, even if we have seen the concessionaire many. So to answer the question is, I don't think in general they have a preferred contract. They have, I mean, they have in the sense that they choose a preferred scheme. But it's not the same for all the countries entering into the new arena, into the new companies. The link between the maturity of the country and the oil characteristic with the scheme, yes, well, when the country is a mature one, maybe has been explored, it can be more used to find different contractor solutions. Let's say I made just brief link. Let's link to the marginal fields. When a country is a mature one, this is a case that can happen. So we can study and have a specific link to the technical characteristic, no? Or maybe it is not marginal field, but it is a new research in deep offshore. Because if a country is a country new in the arena, no? They don't begin exploring the deep offshore. They begin with the onshore, let's say the offshore. Depends on where it is, obviously, geographically. But I would say that the mature country has experienced a lot of contact with the companies, a lot of implementation of the petroleum contract. And it is valuable to, I would say, investigate new frontiers under the contractual point of view, link with the technical characteristic of that country.
And then there was another question on the shale gas and
oh, this is a really, oh, is a big chapter, shale gas. Shale gas, really, it is a new frontier of the petroleum activities. We know that in the United States, this shale gas activity, it is performed since 20 or 30 years, 20 years, I think. And it has brought big changes in the United States petroleum economy. The states, we all know that could become independent soon. Could become independent through this shale gas activity. In Europe, in Eastern Europe, in Far East, and also in Central Asia. Also, Eni is trying to find shale gas new projects connected with this kind of operation. That is very different from the conventional one. So, the impact on the contractual perspective is big. So what I would say is the shale gas activity under the operating point of view is so different from the conventional activity that we should change, for example in a PSA, in a contract, some of the basis of the contract. One simple example. If we keep an area, through a petroleum contract, we know that after 3 years of exploration activity, we release part of the area. After 5 years, another portion, and so on. After a certain period, what is not included in a development and production area, it is completely released, withdrawn. So, in the shale gas activities, the point is different because due to the different kind of activity that move lots of wells from the area to another portion of the area, we should keep that contract area more or less the same for 20-25 years. This is an example of one basic impact on the contractual structure. We, as all companies, are discussing, are trying to do something with the host countries on this. A host country has to understand, in my opinion, that the shale gas activity is really very different from the conventional one. We cannot use really a conventional PSA or a concession agreement for this activity. So, it is the answer to the question is not under the contractual perspective are not the same between conventional and shale gas, and also between instead shale gas and shale oils there are under the contractual perspective more or less the same needs, because we need incentives, fiscal incentives, we need this kind of things, because more than in the conventional, the shale gas activity involves a lot of capital, a lot of money, and we expose ourselves, the oil companies are exposed to a large amount of money. So I would say under the perspective point of view, contractual perspective, shale gas and shale oil are more or less the same in order to be able to negotiate a good contract. And the shale gas and shale oil in respect of the conventional, I take the occasion to say that are very different. So we need to change the contract.
Continue with the third question.
Dov'è la terza, scusa?
Regarding contracts in unconventional projects.
Ah, è questo, sì, no, stavo già trattando.
The conventional one, and we hear about working interest.
But do you know what is the difference?
Participating interest, what's the difference?
No, in general, it depends on the contract and the definition we put inside. We sometimes, usually in the same way, apart from saying that when we carry, for example, the national company, we used to say we have a working interest because we pay for the exploration for the national company or the country. Yes, when we finish this question, by the end of the agreement, it's not only at the end of the agreement, when we make studies, we depend data, we produce documents, we have to give to the government these results of the studies and so on. And we have to remember that the data, also when we drill a well, the data coming from the well, the samples from the well are property, directly, immediately, property of the state. So we can study, we can use, we can export upon authorization outside, but these are property of the state, of the government. So we have not only at the end of the agreement, but in general we have to give a report, studies to the authorities.
Solo una domanda
per Stella. Aspetta, dopo lo vediamo. This is a very 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 clear. The question is clear and the answer is that in the preliminary contact as oil companies, not only Eni, we have in certain countries, at least two or three countries, where we are willing to do new initiatives in the shale gas, if the framework will be fine. This is one of the problems. So there is not a specific legislation for the shale gas. There is not, as we said, specific contract, and we are trying to suggest how to change the conventional contract. So what we can do? In certain countries, we are trying, with other companies, to study a sort of framework interim agreement, framework interim, in order to make a few pilot projects and to bridge together with the country and with the assistance of the data we will obtain from the shale gas activities, the petroleum, to a new contract and a new legislation. But this is a problem. This is really the problem. There is not a legislation. You can imagine, for example, the price of the gas. If there is not a legislation talking about the price of shale gas and to whom you will sell, you can be lost. You can negotiate, but what do you negotiate? If the counterparty is not ready to fix a price or a market to whom export the shale gas. So this is really the the heart of the problem.
Any question from the board? All right. Okay.
Thank you very much. So I appreciate your time. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I just want to say thank you from SPI, and we have your mail address. So we'll keep you informed about the next lecture. I think this is in May, maybe. I want to give a gift to. Do you want to give it?
Come? Aspetta, c'è un'altra domanda. Scusa. Thank you very much. I appreciate. Best wishes. Thank you very much. I appreciate. Thank you very much. Dov'è, scusami, c'è un'altra domanda, Ida? Eh? Ah no, scusa, ho toccato una cosa.
Dov'è? Io non la leggo.
Ah, forse andando sotto, aspetta, scusa.
Ancora più giù? Sì, perché aspettando per ritirare. Qui giù.
Ah, scusami. Questa?
In Cina e Messico c'è una possibilità di esplorazione, prezzo e spot indicizzato al petrolio.
Well, in China, Messico, I'm not, is one of the countries where I'm not involved, so I don't know now currently as it is. But in China, yes, there are obviously many possibilities of exploration. I don't know if it is referred to shale gas or in general, but for shale gas this possibility, I think is referred to shale gas, So it is there is possibility in China. Well, I would say, under technical point of view, the shale gas reserves, as deemed estimated, are the first in the world. Are the first, according to certain USA estimates, are the first in the world. So China. Yes, effectively, for shale gas activity, it can be an interesting country, but due to the fact that there is not still a legislation, we do not know the price, how it could be formulated. For the exploration and conventional activities, it is different because we have CSET, for example, is a very nice joint venture, mixed operating structure, and now, after 35 years of production, it is becoming to be closer to its end of the activities, I think. But the price is sold, there is a sale of the petroleum produced at market prices, in international markets and so on. So, but for the shale, the answer is that we do not know. If we should decide to progress on that, we know that we have a problem to be clarified in the negotiations, provided that the authorities are ready to clarify. Because if they are not ready, we can handle the matter, probably not in China, but in general, with a framework interim. Approved by the authorities because they give you some incentives, vacation on the payment of royalties or something like that. And we can bridge to have the final contract, let's say for 2, 3, 4, 5 years maximum with a few pilot projects. And in the meantime, they prepare legislation and the contract. And in the meantime, we do activities and this could be a mean, but the price is one of the basic issues. Un'altra c'è? No, basta. Bene. Grazie, scusami. Ma smettilo. Va bene. Grazie che sei venuto. Hai visto che bel libro?